Let's continue to discuss the ways in which glaciers are melting. This is a nice image with a radar. So when you look at satellite images, it looks like Antarctica is just white desert with strong winds and nothing in it, no features. But radars actually track the fine radiances coming from differences in surface at very fine scales. So this is ice deformation being measured at a scale of few millimeters per day. So ice flows happening. So you can see these bird foot features look like river deltas where the glaciers are flowing. And if the the rates are different here, the purplish red colors are fast flows and the brown to green colors are slower. If the glacier is flowing fast, then it is thinning, and if it's flowing slowly, then it can accumulate mass and grow. Okay, so the rivers of ice and glaciers reach into the continent or drain into the narrow corridors at a few locations along the coast. You can see all these features here. Okay, so the glaciers actually control the flow of ice into the sea, and we will see that the processes at the edge, especially with the warming of the ocean, begin to create lots of ways in which the glacier breaks off and discharges into the ocean and then melts away, and the glacier that remains on land adjusts in terms of either the discharge rate, flow rate, or calving, and so on. Calving is the way in which the edge of the ice breaks off. Okay, so this is the kind of broken off ice shelf that we talked about before in Antarctic region. So this is called a tabular iceberg. So you can see that literally it's like a flat table, and all these are like broken up after melting with the ice breaking up because of the heat exchange and melting from below by the ocean. So if the ocean is not frozen, obviously it's much warmer than the iceberg that's on top. So when the iceberg is here, the ocean is heavily insulated because this is a good insulator. But where the ocean is open, it loses lots of heat to the atmosphere, and it can refreeze. Or it can continue to break the glacier into pieces and eventually melt away. The freezing point of water is typically -2 degrees centigrade because of salt in it. Remember, when there is snow forecasts, salt trucks come by and spray salt all over the surfaces because they want to reduce the freezing temperature. And with pressure, the freezing temperature can reach less than -3 degrees centigrade. So there is a pressure effect and there is a salinity effect on freezing, whereas ice obviously freezes at 0 degrees centigrade. So there's that difference. So this is a tabular iceberg seen among the sea ice just off the Larsen Sea ice shelf. So we'll see an example where the iceberg actually, the shelf ice actually broke off. Remember the difference we saw between Greenland and Antarctica. Antarctica has these glaciers flowing onto the ocean and forming shelf ice, whereas Greenland icebergs tend to be typically much taller than wider. Then they are wide, so they typically tend to tip over. That's a big difference. So these are beautiful pictures from a tourist website inviting people to visit Greenland, and you can imagine how amazing it is to be near there watching these icebergs. But of course it's not good news. So there is another example of how the ice reaches the ocean, melts on contact with the ice from below, because there is with the ocean from below. So it's warm, salty ocean water. Unfrozen water is obviously warmer. You can't get a good sense, but this is 800 meters tall and 3 kilometers wide. So this is about icebergs, the same types that the Titanic hit, for example. So typically only 10% of the volume is above water in these cases, and 90% is below, but still they can be unstable depending on how they broke off. Okay, so for a long time scientists thought that most of the meltwater reaching the ocean was due to the breakup of the icebergs, but actually from the 1990s there is much more data now showing that the ice melts a lot from below. Okay, so they are orders of magnitude faster than the melt you would get at the surface. Here is another example of stretching and breaking of icebergs as they hit water, and the density of the iceberg, the temperatures, the strain on the iceberg as it is getting stretched while flowing down into the water and so on determine the size of the chunks of icebergs that break off. But you can clearly see these here. Just to run through some schematics of the processes, the crevasse is formed typically because of the stretching. You can see several of the crevasses in this iceberg here hitting the water in Antarctica. And the water-free crevasse then gets filled with water, which freezes and begins to pry it open. So the ice pressure can close the crevasse if it's not filled with water, but if it's filled with water, then it begins to, the water freezes because it's now in the cold glacier, so that then begins to pry it open. So it really depends on the details of the processes. Here you have a slower glacier flow on the upstream side of the glacier where there is positive mass balance, so the accretion is more than, let's say, ablation, and there is a point on the slope towards the water body where the glacier flow is getting faster. So the zone of ice stretching and crevasse formation happens here, and the calving and the breaking off of the icebergs also happens over there because of the processes like a basal drag that is going to tip it over and expand the crevasse and then break it off. You can also have zone of maximum stress on crevasses where the flow is going to create a strain on the glacier, but the water that's holding it up doesn't have as much pressure as the glacier that's flowing down, so you end up basically splitting it open and breaking it apart. Just kind of schematics, but these are the observed processes. You have to imagine the difficulty of actually modeling these for making accurate projections into the future about the speed with which the icebergs will break off of Antarctica or Greenland. Clearly a very difficult process, but there are people who dedicate their lives to taking the data, understanding the processes, and building models so that they can be run into the future. To force them, you need the ocean temperatures, the winds, the snowfall rates, etc., which will come from the climate model or what are called Earth system models, which have also dynamic vegetation, carbon cycle, and so on and so forth. So obviously that gets fairly complicated. The other way it can happen is that the glacier, which is lighter, obviously floats, and then the water can force that upward and break it off here and create a glacier by calving off a piece of that. This is erosional notch forming. Let's say the tides are constantly hitting the glacier and beginning to chop into the iceberg at the edges and eventually break it off. So you can see the notch undercutting the ice cliff. So there we will see that there is a marine ice cliff instability like this, and there is a marine ice sheet instability that happen under slightly different circumstances. Another example, zone of earlier calving events leaves the glacier underwater, sticking out with water flowing on top. And then crevasses are going to be again subjected to these calving processes. This is called a subaqueous ice foot that is left behind because of the earlier calving event that happened. So you can see these kind of massive cracks opening up. This is almost looks like a boulder, but actually this is an iceberg covered with debris. And remember, the albedo effect is going to be severely amplified in these cases because the pure ice, which is very bright and can reflect sunlight, almost 90, 95, 97% of it, depending on how fresh the snow is. The debris-covered glaciers obviously have very low albedo, and they begin to absorb a lot of the solar energy, and then that accelerates the melting as well. Okay, so all those are kind of the processes that create ice melting and accelerate them as well. We'll see some more details as we go along, as well as the differences between Greenland and Antarctica, which is very critical